Good morning, Interweb. Let's world build. So, here's my star, and my gas giant. My gas giant, a Jupiter analog, orbits my star, a Sol analog, at a distance of 5.2 AU, and has an expansive Saturnian-style ring system. Gas giant rings should be placed between about 1.34 and 2.44 planetary radii from the center of the giant planet, plus or minus 0.2 in either direction, if you want. My rings extend from 15 to 27 Earth radii out. Note that in my case, one planetary radii equals 11 Earth radii. Now, gas giants will normally have up to three distinct groups of satellites, A, B, and C. The first group of moons, the A group, are a close-in cluster of irregularly shaped minor moons who all share the following characteristics. 1. They orbit in the outer half of the ring system and just beyond it. 2. They will be spaced about 0.25 to 1.5 Earth radii from each other. 3. They'll be on the order of tens to early hundreds of kilometers in size. And 4. They're held together not by gravitation, but rather tensile strength. It's the latter that allows them to exist within the planet's Roche limit. So let's do this. I'll start at about 25 Earth radii out, and place another moon here, here, and here. And then I'll place two co-orbital moons at about 28 Earth radii out, just beyond the edge of the rings. I know what you're thinking. These moons seem impossibly close together. 0.25 Earth radii, that's like the distance from New York to Denver, right? What's up with that? Crazy as it may sound, this sort of orbital spacing can, in fact, be seen in Saturn's inner moons. Why? Because resonances. In order for objects to tightly pack together, they need to be in mean motion resonance with themselves and/or with more distant objects. By right, we should be setting up a complicated web of resonances here, but boy is that a massive time dump for little to no payoff. The 0.25 to 1.5 Earth radii spacing gives the impression of mean motion resonances without the tedium of actually working them out. But if you're that sort of nerd, check out this video and get calculating. More power to you. Last thing to note here is that these moons are embedded within the rings. So they'll act as shepherd moons, clearing out and corralling ring debris. Thus, where there be moons, there also be gaps. The second group, the B group, will be a satellite system's main group, featuring a handful of large, regular, major moons. Some rules here. 1. Their domain lies between about 3 and 15 planetary radii out from the gas giant's center. 2. No two major moons should come within one planetary radius of each other. And 3. Their mass should be less than 0.0001 times the mass of the giant planet. So I'll place a major moon here, 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 and here. Cool thing is that we can also incorporate some minor moons here as Lagrangian companions to these major moons. Like so. Need a refresher in Lagrange points? No probs. Check out this video. Now it's worth checking to see if any of your major moons have a 2-to-1 mean motion resonance that falls within the ring system. That is, are there any orbits within the ring system that have material orbiting twice for every one orbit of a major moon? If so, this area will likely be the location of a major gap in your ring system, a la Saturn's Cassini division. In my system here, my innermost moon and anything at 22.05 Earth radii in the rings are in resonance. So I'll place a gap of about 0.5 Earth radii here. Just remember, when filling in the physical characteristics of your moons, give this particular moon a relatively high mass in order to maintain that gap. Speaking of which, check out these videos on how to construct the physical and orbital characteristics of satellites. But remember, don't forget the moon mass rule. So, the final group, the C group, are a collection of distant, irregular minor moons / captured asteroids. That is, day 1, orbit between 20 planetary radii out and the edge of the planet's hill sphere. 2. Orbit on highly inclined, highly eccentric, and sometimes even retrograde orbits, and 3. Their size will be on the order of tens of kilometers. So from last time, the planet's hill sphere in Earth radii is given by this equation. In this case, my outer boundary lies about 8,358 Earth radii out from the planet's center. Plenty of room. I'm going to set up two distinct families of distant moon in this system, the C1 and C2 group. The C1 group has about 8 members, all of which are on prograde, highly inclined orbits, with eccentricities between 0.1 and 0.3. And the more distant C2 group has about 10 members on retrograde and even more inclined orbits, and whose orbital eccentricities lie between 0.2 and 0.5. Again, for all you data files out there, you could go through each satellite here and calculate its orbital trajectory. Links here for more on this. If you do, you'll end up with something looking like this. Just remember, do not cross the 20 planetary radii boundary. And that right there is how one constructs a gas giant's satellite system. But let's face it, you're here for one thing, and one thing alone. So if we want to replicate James Cameron's Pocahontas, we're going to need to move our gas giant into the habitable zone, and give it an Earth-like moon. We've two options here. Either the gas giant migrates inwards and holds onto an already in-situ Earth mass moon, or it migrates, loses all of its moons, and recaptures an Earth mass object that was floating around the inner system. Neither scenario is perfect. Like, to ensure atmospheric retention and the presence of a magnetic field, scientists estimate the mass range of habitable moons should lie roughly between 0.25 and 2 Earth masses. This is way, way, way more massive than any in-situ solar system moon. And, using our moon mass guideline from earlier, implies that its gas giant must be like at least 7 to 8 times the mass of Jupiter. But that isn't the main issue. The big problem here is that such a moon, having formed in the outer system, will be icy. Migrate the whole system inwards and you'll thaw the moon, and perhaps create a water world. But if we're aiming for something more Earth-like, capture after migration is the way to go. That way the moon isn't bound by the moon mass guideline. We can design it to fit our needs. And we also need to think about stellar mass. Habitable moons should be placed around stars greater than 0.2 solar masses. Below this, tidal heating, radiation, and runaway greenhouse effects become a serious issue. Now, once ensnared, ensure that the moon orbits between 10 and 20 planetary radii from the center of the giant, and ensure that its orbital eccentricity is below 0.01. As an extra stability measure, ensure that the ratio of the moon's orbital period, given by this equation from the previous video, and the planet's orbital period is less than 1 over 9. Interestingly, all captured objects tend to be irregular satellites. So, in theory, we could place our moon on an inclined or even retrograde orbit. And there you have it, habitable moon, done. But hey, this is world building. We can do something more imaginative than this. So remember earlier I mentioned that two of my inner moons were co-orbital. Yes, co-orbital can imply Lagrangian partners, but I was thinking more along the lines of a horseshoe orbit. Saturn's moons Janus and Epimetheus do this exact thing. Here's the deal. They both share nearly identical orbits. Epimetheus, being closer to Saturn, will be traveling faster and will approach Janus from behind. The closer the two get, the more they gravitationally tug on one another. Epimetheus slows Janus down, which makes it fall towards Saturn, and Janus speeds Epimetheus up, moving it away from Saturn, i.e. they switch places. Janus, now being closer to Saturn, races ahead, leaving Epimetheus in its wake, until the whole situation is reversed 4 years later. Basically, this. Now let's imagine instead of having two punitive hunks of rock, we have two full-blown habitable Earth-like moons that orbit on horseshoe orbits. What would such a system look like? Well, imagine standing on one of the moons. Looking up, you'll see the other moon rush towards you, pause, and then flee back from whence it came. Leg it over to the other side of the planet, and you get to witness the whole event again half a period later. In and of itself, this setup is cool. Two Earths forever chasing each other around the gas giant. But imagine if a civilization on one moon became technologically advanced before a civilization on the other moon. Imagine prehistoric peoples looking up into the sky and seeing a world emblazoned with all the marks of technological advancement. Pretty cool, eh? Could this happen in real life? Probably not. But like I said, this is world building. Good morning, Interweb. So those of you who watched my last Q&A video will know that I'm trying to go back to college to study astrophysics. And as such, I'm taking maths grinds to try and get my maths up to a college level standard. Now, as with everything in life, these grinds don't come free. And I was beginning to worry about whether or not I could afford them and continue doing them. But as luck would have it, YouTube has just started paying me, which is insane. Like, it's not a lot of money or anything, but it's enough to directly cover the cost of those grinds per month. And this is unbelievable. Like, this really makes a difference to me, and I just wanted to say thank you. I don't really have the vocabulary necessary to express just how grateful I am, but because of you watching these videos and supporting Artifexian, I get to do the things I want to do in life. And that is unbelievable. I am privileged, I am honored, and I am internally indebted to you. You are, each and every one of you are just amazing. Thank you so much. Anyways, soppy thank yous all the way. Click the links on screen or in the description for more Artifexian content. Like, and if you think I earned it, hit the subscribe button. Thank you all so much for watching. Edgar out.